Bernard Malmus. I'm in the School of Modern Languages, as Ambreen said, but I'm here tonight really in the function as co-convener. Okay. Hello? Okay, good, wonderful. Okay. Thanks for your patience. I'm Bernard Malmus in the School of Modern Languages, but I'm here tonight in the function as co-convener of the Anthropocene Research Group. What is the Anthropocene Research Group? It's a group of researchers, students, scholars, teachers who are interested in the future of this planet. And we are exploring environmental issues, environmental global crisis, and we're trying to bring a cross-disciplinary conversation to the table to address these kind of issues. It's a great pleasure tonight to introduce Graeme Parks to you as our guest speaker within the Insights lecture series. We've tried to bring Graeme here for a number of years and then the pandemic threw a spanner in the works. So really glad that he could make it now. Graeme Parks was born and raised in Glasgow. He went to Oxford to study philosophy and psychology and then did his PhD in Berkeley and spent a large part of his career in Hawaii teaching philosophy, Asian philosophy and comparative philosophy. He then moved to University College in Cork and in 2015 to Vienna, where he is currently a professorial research fellow at the University of Vienna. Just going to mention a few publications of his. He edited two volumes on Heidegger and Asian thought and Nietzsche and Asian thought that have become classics in the meantime. He's published numerous articles on intercultural philosophy, comparative environmental philosophy, and Buddhism and aesthetics. And most recently, he's published a book called How to Think About the Climate Crisis, A Philosophical Guide to Saner Ways of Living. And this book constitutes the context for our invitation to Graeme. So please join me in welcoming Graeme Parks to Newcastle. He will speak on Can Humanity Survive the Anthropocene? It depends on who we think we are. Welcome, Graeme.
Thank you very much, Bernard. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Now that we don't have the fires burning. Sorry, we had incredible technical problems balancing the sound, and so there's a bit more sound right at the end. But you can hear me okay at the back? All right, good. So, those were excerpts from the Buddha's fire sermon, which he delivered. Sorry, I realize I need to do something here. Okay, which he delivered to an assembly of 1,000 monks who had come from a cult of fire worshippers. And that accounts for all the fire imagery in his description of the human condition. And if we, oh, sorry, this is not. Oh, I have to point it. Ah, yeah, there we go, right. So maybe I'll stand over here. This part we didn't rehearse. Okay. I inserted into the text of the fire sermon a list of countries that were literally burning in 2021, which was a devastating year for wildfires around the world. And what you're seeing here is a 10-day compilation of images from a NASA satellite at some point during 2021. And the fire-caused wars that are still burning in Ukraine right now are connected with those wildfires. Russia leads the world in gas exports. Comes in second in exports of oil. Sorry, I see I need to practice this. And takes third place among exporters of coal. It's a fossil fuel monster, responsible for monstrous amounts of carbon emissions. I didn't realize this until after the Ukraine war had started, but just think for a moment what this means. If we had begun to wean ourselves from fossil fuels 30 years ago, when it was already clear that burning them was disrupting the climate, Putin could not have afforded his war against Ukraine. And so, the quicker we stop burning, the sooner he'll be unable to finance another war. I'm beginning with fire because the consequences of our pyromania as a species are becoming so severe as to prompt the question of my title. Can we survive the Anthropocene? The new epoch of the Earth system that Homo so-called sapiens has brought about. Because the natural sciences and common sense, if we think about it, make it clear that as human beings, we are totally dependent for our survival on the biosphere and other Earth systems. Sorry. Which you see here. And if we burn up our resource base, we destroy ourselves as a species. So it could well turn out, in the most tragic of ironies, that after achieving the distinction of having a geological epoch named after it, the human race will bring itself to a lethal finish. The pyromaniacal anthropos might well put an end to the Anthropocene. So, part one, where we are now. Let me begin by considering what's behind this pyromania of ours. Because, like the audience for the Buddha's fire sermon, we too are fire worshippers, even if covertly. When early humans learned the uses of fire, it made them more human. We became Homo pyrotechnicus. Human-made fire was at first restricted by the amount of fuel available, but then expanded with the advent of agriculture and the ability to grow vegetation for burning more fuel for more burning. But with industrial fire and the ability, with industrial fire to power steam engines and steam pumps, modern miners could delve deeper into the earth than ever before, reaching back in geological time to extract fossil fuel biomass that was deposited during the Carboniferous period. Today, we're burning more than ever before, but now the fires are hidden from our sight. It's no wonder that our relentless burning of coal, especially, which releases energy that came in from the sun over 300 million years ago, along with massive amounts of carbon, should now be throwing Earth's energy balance off by filling the atmosphere with heat-trapping gases. According to the latest reports from the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change, the sixth series of them since 1990, this human activity is having a potentially catastrophic effect on the Earth system. Now, the EPC is something I don't enter into any conversation about climate change anymore with anyone who hasn't read the latest report, which came out on Monday. So don't let it be said either that Parks just rehashes old stuff. I've reworked the first part of this part of the paper in the light of the synthesis report that came out on Monday. They have hundreds of scientists look over thousands, everything that's been published in the climate sciences. They come from most of the 200 member nations of the IPCC. Politicians get involved, multiple drafts. I mean, any biases any one person might have get ironed out by the time these reports hit. In fact, when you look at the number of people involved, thousands of people, none of them get paid for their work, by the way, it's a wonder they can agree on anything at all. And this latest synthesis report you can't read the small print there. It says, it's so hot, this take. It says, do not cite, quote, or distribute. So you didn't hear me saying any of this. you're not here, I didn't know you were here. I don't know why they say it, it's on their website, but I'm not going to cite or quote or distribute it, really. It's only 36 pages. It was on the previous site, ipcc.ch. Download for free, you can get it anytime. Then you can talk to me about climate change. Okay, this is the list of authors. It's about a tenth of them, it's the first page, of this latest summary. And you see, they come from a number of different places. And the problem is that the problem is that we've already pumped so much greenhouse gas into the climate system that even if we were to stop tomorrow, which we couldn't, or drastically reduce our emissions almost immediately, which we could but won't, we're likely to produce a temperature increase of 1.6 degrees over pre-industrial times by the middle of the century. And that is a sobering prospect, and I don't know why more people aren't sobered by it. Let's look at how they put it in. Okay, they say continued greenhouse gases emissions will lead to increasing global warming. Every increment of global warming will intensify multiple and concurrent hazards. So the point is, getting up to 1.6 fairly soon isn't just a 50% increase, because in the Earth's systems and complex systems, increases are not linear but exponential. So we're talking about, in fact, I think it says it on the next slide. They're saying projected long-term impacts are up to multiple times higher than currently observed. And they say that with high confidence. So if you think back to the last year or two of climate, I think we've been lucky here in this part of Europe, but many places, no place is exempt. You know, a couple of years ago, British Columbia hit 49 degrees Celsius. I mean, it's insane. And so if you think of the climate disasters in the last year or two, multiply that by, what do we want? Two times worse, three times, four times, five times? I mean, it's going to get bad. Unless they do have where they say, the likelihood of abrupt and or irreversible changes increases with higher global warming levels. The probability of low likelihood outcomes associated with potentially very large adverse impacts increases with higher global warming levels. High confidence. They're talking about these tipping points. You may have read about them in various parts of the Earth systems. There are points that we're getting very close to that if we go over it, we lose the game. I mean, the climate spins out of control. There's nothing we can do about it. So we really want to avoid those. That's the thing we want to avoid most. But also, let's not let it get up to, we're headed now for an increase of 3 degrees instead of 1.6. So let's make it 1.5, if we can. Now, climate scientists have been complaining for decades that the IPCC reports underestimate the risks, because there are so many people involved that it's actually a very conservative projection. So I think, we won't go into... I think there isn't time and it's too depressing to go into... Let's just assume that we'll not have crossed tipping points. Now, this whole situation is made worse by the fact that the big banks are continuing to lend billions to the fossil fuel concerns. See, since the Paris agreements were signed in 2016, in those 4 years, they lent $3.8 trillion to the fossil fuel concerns to find more fossil fuels to burn. They didn't lend them just for their day-to-day operations, but to get more. And these are the banks. And in fact, recently, Bill McKibben has been saying, if you have money in any of those banks, take it out, because that's also contributing. The money in the bank allows them to lend more. So if we name and shame them, I mean, I've named them, you shame them, then we stand a chance of that's one place where we can actually do something about this situation. The other thing is they've realized we're starting to do this. Some people are. They're going into the bond markets now. So if you know what bond markets are, encourage your friends to do something about what the banks are doing with those. So a review by The Guardian, this was in May of 2022, identified no fewer than 195 carbon bombs under development. And they defined that as gigantic oil and gas projects that would each, singly, result in at least a billion tons of CO2 emissions over their lifetimes. 195 billion tons. They're doing this, they're planning this, they're getting it ready. If the banks stop lending money, they'll have trouble. But this is amazing that all these governments said, oh, we're going to fix the problem, but you can see that the worst ones are in the US, surprise, surprise. Saudi Arabia isn't doing very well, Russia not. This is where these projects to get more carbon, fossil fuels out of the ground are going to take place unless we can stop it somehow. So, to neutralize such ruthless forces, we need not only judicious action, but also political activism. Because if we in the developed world, I call it the overdeveloped world, immersed in the consumerist dream of endless abundance on a finite planet, fail to change our lives, the consequent scarcity of resources will oblige us to reduce our consumption drastically. And that's the question. I mean, do we want to be forced to do it because things get so bad and most of the planet is uninhabitable? Or are we going to change our ways, have to do that rather radically, and have some agency in how this plays out? Right, that's the most depressing part over. You'll be pleased to hear. Now we'll do some ancient history. Some ancient views on how we are, who we are. The idea of the Buddha's fire sermon is that our experience as human beings is ordinarily permeated by the metaphorical fires of craving, hatred, and delusion. And these keep us, these fires keep us bound to cycles of desire and frustration. As long as we think of ourselves as independent agents striving to fulfill their desires, we are bound to be frustrated. But if we realize our actual interdependence, we can escape those cycles and find a middle way between clinging and detachment, or indulgence and asceticism. We don't need to become ascetics, we just need to not overindulge, as far as the Buddhists are concerned. In a later Buddhist scripture, the Lotus Sutra, human beings are likened to the children of a rich man whose huge mansion is burning down. But they are so joyfully absorbed in the games they're playing that he can't persuade them to escape from the burning house. He then tells them that there are far more attractive things outside, playthings outside the mansion, which he's happy to give to them. Whereupon, they all rush out of the house in high anticipation. What they find there is a selection of animal-drawn carts. And I suppose for modern children, the equivalent would be sports cars. But each of the carts, they're nice playthings, each of them is emblematic of a particular school of Buddhist teaching. So the idea is that much more attractive than the things we get entranced by are the Buddhist teachings, and they'll do us more good. So let's go to this one, yeah. Western civilization, to come back to that, is built on the basis of burning fossil fuels. Unwittingly, we are members of the cult of Prometheus, the Titan in ancient Greek myth who stole fire from the gods to give it to humans. And I suggest that we understand myth in the sense of the philosopher Sallustius, who said this about them. He said, "These things never happened, but always are." So myth is not some kind of proto-science or some primitive attempt to talk about reality. Myths are talking about things that are always going on that are playing out behind what human beings are doing. Now, in addition to fire, Prometheus also gave humans the stolen arts of agriculture and animal husbandry. House and shipbuilding, as well as techniques for mining. Now, these arts in Greek are technai. So that's the root of our word technologies. So Prometheus gave us the ability to come up with technologies whose purpose is to make human life more comfortable. Now, Plato has an interesting treatment of the Prometheus myth in the Protagoras, and his treatment suggests significant limitations to the gifts that the Titan bestowed on us. While Prometheus was able to steal technical wisdom from the gods, as Plato puts it, humanity did not get the political wisdom, for that remained in the keeping of Zeus. So, what Plato is saying there is that, inspired by the spirit of Prometheus, humanity has become supremely skilled in the technical arts of survival and comfort creation, while forgetting that these skills are gifts and stolen goods at the same time. But humanity lacks the political arts that would integrate technological expertise with the art of living well together in diverse communities. So that those passages in the Protagoras are well worth reading. And let us not forget that Prometheus, whose sacrilegious theft set in train so much technical ingenuity, suffered dreadful punishment for his crime. Zeus had the Titan nailed to a rock on a mountaintop for 1,000 years, with an eagle coming every day to devour his liver, which would regenerate overnight to be ready for another bout of torment the next day. That's something worth thinking about. Think of it as a metaphor. So, of course, we human beings need fire, and we need to build houses, and we need to practice agriculture in order to survive. But the point is, we could practice those arts and employ those techniques sustainably. So it's not, I'm not getting down on the Promethean drive totally, I'm just saying it's dangerous, it's got us to where we are now, but it can be tamed, it can be tempered, we could do it sustainably. But if, as proteges of Prometheus, we let his spirit drive us to excess in burning fossil fuels, treating soil with fertilizers and crops with pesticides, and industrially producing meat from animals, it would be naive not to expect some kind of serious backlash. There's a continuity in the images here. My wife drew this image for the cover of the book, and it depicts the best case scenario. The Earth goddess Gaia is actually rising and prevailing over the punished Prometheus. So that's what I like to imagine. Okay, now, coming up to the modern period, who do the libertarians claim we are? Because they are engaged in a war of ideas that I think they're winning. They're persuading us that we are someone different from who we actually are, I think. So, we're in the climate crisis because several decades ago, a small group of neoliberal economists, allied with some very rich people, launched a covert war of ideas to persuade the inhabitants of the free world that we are basically consumers in a capitalist system that's guaranteed to satisfy our material desires. The story begins in London shortly after the Second World War, but with an Austrian economist from Vienna, Friedrich August von Hayek, who emphasized the importance of what he called the battle of ideas in promoting the cause of freedom. Now, if you think of the context, it was the world, he was speaking, the world suffering the consequences of totalitarianism. And Hayek's book from 1944, The Road to Serfdom, was a big hit. And his message of untrammeled freedom of both the individual and the markets, and economic markets, was received with great enthusiasm. And I think nowadays by the libertarians, especially in the US, continue to be enthusiastic about untrammeled freedom of the individual and the market. Another key assumption of neoliberal ideology is that we live in a world dominated by competition. And as a species, Homo sapiens gained the position of apex predator by competing with other species. And within the species, this is the idea, we compete as individuals in a struggle for success in which the cleverest prevail. This is how free market capitalism works. Leave it up to the market and everything will be better for everybody, including the consumer, but especially for the capitalist or CEO. If the free individual is to thrive, the free market must be kept free and taxation and regulation kept to a minimum. As David Harvey offers a fine account of subsequent developments in his short history of neoliberalism. Basically, thanks to the influence of Hayek and then Milton Friedman and Paul Volcker in the US, neoliberal ideology came to dominate the policies of you-know-who, of Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher from 1980 onward, and also outward to conquer much of the rest of the world's political leadership. With her famous pronouncement, "There is no such thing as society, only individual men and women," Thatcher perfectly embodied the spirit of neoliberalism and its expansion from economics into politics and society as libertarianism. So, I mean, normally if it's economics, people say it's neoliberal. I'm talking more about the whole thing, so I'll use the word libertarian. Thatcher was an intelligent woman, but in that quote, I think she got it spectacularly backwards. I mean, what's real, it seems to me, are the populations that make up the society of any given country when you talk about British society, right? That's us in this country. Whereas the individual is actually an abstraction from that concrete reality. Thatcher's credentials as a supreme warrior in the libertarian war of ideas are summed up in her, for me, even more remarkable statement of purpose from 1981. "Economics are the method. The object is to change the heart and soul." Now, it's remarkable that so few people found this objective sinister, as I do. That's the objective, to change our hearts and souls without even asking our permission. In any case, she and her followers have been unusually successful because they didn't ask our permission in changing the hearts and souls of countless people since then. But we've really bought into this neoliberal ideology. Now, some of that success is due to a very effective campaign in the War of Ideas to convince people that economics provides the most important measure of human flourishing. But it's only a very recent conceit that economics and economists can give us the right standards for anything except economic activity. It would be wonderful, as one of the greatest modern economists once suggested, it would be wonderful if economists could manage to get themselves thought of as humble, competent people on a level with dentists. I mean, you know, we need dentists, we need economists, but we haven't yet deified the dental profession, but we seem to have deified. You know, no politician is going to do anything if someone says, "Well, but the economics of it don't work." Well, screw the economics of it, I say. Okay, as a result of Reagan's and Thatcher's policies, the rich libertarians have been able to buy the political system, especially in the United States. The Koch brothers and their Freedom Partners Action Fund have been major supporters of the War of Ideas, buying their way into universities, setting up right-wing think tanks, and founding fake grassroots citizen activist groups to spread and weaponize the libertarian ideology. They and their allies donated millions to get Donald Trump elected, and then immediately issued a roadmap to repeal, containing a list of things they wanted the Trump administration to do. And at the end of 2017, they congratulated themselves and the Trump administration for getting these things done, like Brexit, a highly successful business transaction. I think the most spectacular one was the Paris Agreement. That must be on a different slide, sorry. But anyway, if you actually look into it, it's remarkable that they bought the Trump administration and it was a very good investment, apparently. If you buy a... Do we have the... There it is. Anything to do with the EPA was scrapped and withdraw the US from the Paris Agreement. if you buy a government, and it seems to me from the distance of Vienna that this has also happened in the UK, certainly happened in many other countries, Brazil comes to mind, you have a great deal of power over how people live, especially if you control how free market capitalism operates. Now, this is a widespread solution, but with a fairly simple, widespread problem with a fairly simple solution: get private money out of politics. They almost did it in the US with the Campaign Finance Reform Act 15 years ago. If you look at Scandinavian countries, it can be done. You can have elections where it's all state money that's used for them. So it's simple. I'm not saying it's easy, but we have to, in that sense, make democracy work and get the 99% to vote. Because at the moment, politics are distorted, the markets are distorted, everything is distorted by the huge amount of money flowing in from especially the fossil fuel industry. But to go further with the neoliberal agenda, and they want to go further, and influence how people want to live, not just how they live, but how they want to live, you also need to make sure your libertarian allies control the mass media. And then you could probably count on social media to do the rest for you. In expanding free market so as to encompass all human activity, the right-wing billionaires have had to work closely with the libertarians behind the latest information and communications technology, what I call the tech titans of Silicon Valley. Excuse me. This is all too anger-provoking, and I had to calm down a bit. Right. So now we get to... Oh, sorry. And if we think about the climate cost of big tech infrastructure, that's huge. Bitcoin, those things are even more huge. And now what have we got? ChatGPT? Everyone's doing it, at least everyone I know except me is doing it. This takes a lot of servers on the ground, getting very hot and having to be cooled and using lots of electricity, most of which is powered by fossil fuels. I have just remembered something here. No, that's not going to work. Okay, so let's go on to section 4, high-tech spectacle. These titans of big tech have given us the supreme version of what Guy Debord presciently described as le spectacle, the spectacle. And why are we not seeing it? There we go. And he wrote, everything that used to be lived directly has now shifted into a representation. Now, that was in 1967. This is a very prescient book, very short. I highly recommend it. That was in 1967 when television and cinema were the dominant visual media. He should see us now gazing transfixed into the representation film filled virtual spaces in our smartphones. That's what you see in a smartphone screen. At least I don't. I don't have a smartphone, but most people do, and that's what you see, our representations. The spectacle is a profoundly un-Buddhist enterprise, designed not to wake us up, the name of the Buddha is the awakened one, but rather to keep us in a stupor. Its soporific quality comes from the transformation of things into images. As De Boer puts it, he puts it more simply, simple images become real beings and effective motivators of hypnotic behavior. So there's something hypnotic about the images that constitute the spectacle. And when consumerism shifts into high gear, the sleep is anything but restful. Longer quote from him, the spectacle is the bad dream of modern society in chains and ultimately expresses nothing more than its desire to sleep. The spectacle is the guardian of that sleep. If you know philosophy, you think of Plato's cave. It sort of keeps us, the spectacle keeps us in the darkness of the cave. A society in chains, captivated and motivated by images, just as in Plato's cave, a mass of sleepers and restless dreamers. But also a society in which the spectacle deliberately intensifies individualism. Again, last quote from De Boer, isolation is at the basis of the technologies, and the technical process isolates in return. From the automobile to television, the goods selected by the spectacular system are also its weapons for constantly reinforcing the conditions that produce lonely crowds. And nowadays, our favorite pastime seems to be what I call screening reality. Now, most people think of screens as windows of some kind, something through which we see into another world, even if it's a virtual world. But in its original meaning, a screen is something that blocks or conceals some of what's around it. Take this kind of screen. Room partition screens, fire screens, window screens, and so on. One root of our word screen means shield. This works much better in German because Bildschirm, the German for a screen, literally means image shield. So my question is, what are these images on our screens shielding us from or shielding us against? Okay, Naomi Klein, her excellent study of the power of corporate branding, no logo, showed how forcefully the modern corporation imposes on us an ideology of the good consumer life. She described how the corporate obsession, I'm quoting, with brand identity is waging a war on many institutions, but crucially, she wrote, on youthful identities, on young people's sense of who they are. Now that was in 1999, and many youthful identities are by now completely dissolved into profiles on social media and immersed in late capitalist ideas about how they should want to live. As good libertarians, the tech titans operate behind the scenes here, addicting us to these apps of theirs. They operate free from taxes and regulations, and free to addict and manipulate their users, depriving them of time to attend to where they actually are, and depriving them of time to attend to any risks that might be imminent, such as the risk from climate change, for example. Because I asked my daughter about this, she has a smartphone, and I say, do you see a whole lot about the climate crisis through your phone? And she said, not really, it's not, it's happening too slowly, is one thing. These tech titans are expert at addicting their users. Interesting that they call them users, because they, the tech titans or their researchers, have studied their Marshall McLuhan, going back even farther in time, who remarked some years earlier than Guy Debord that the narcotic effects of new media technologies. If the medium is the message, as McLuhan has it, then worrying about the content of the new media is beside the point. That we don't need to worry about what, I mean, we can worry, there are things to worry about, but it's more the medium itself. And McLuhan wrote, "Our conventional response to all media, namely that it's how they are used that counts, is the numb stance of the technological idiot. For the content of a medium is like the juicy piece of meat carried by the burglar to distract the watchdog of the mind." This guy was onto it remarkably early, one of the first people. Walter Benjamin, I think, was a bit earlier, obviously. So amidst all this distraction, because that's the whole point, to distract our attention away from where we are, our minds are being changed. I mean, this is Thatcher's dream come true, unobtrusively, by the manipulators from Silicon Valley. Now, I think few people have stated this problem more succinctly than the novelist J.M. Coetzee. Sorry, I forgot to give you a slide there. And this novel, Youth, which is sort of semi-autobiographical, the protagonist of this novel is a missing page. Yeah, sorry, is a young computer programmer in London in the early 1960s. In the course of his evening readings in the history of logic, it's the kind of thing that computer programmers used to read in the evenings, he begins to wonder about the computer. There are many alternative logics, he is convinced, but how many? Each just as good as the logic of either or. The threat of the toy, the threat of the toy by which he earns his living, meaning the mainframe computer, the threat that makes it more than just a toy, is that it will burn either or paths into the brains of its users and thus lock them irreversibly into its binary logic. Now, I think that's powerfully put, and it's actually what's happening. I mean, the neurophysiologists are finding that the structures of the brain are being changed by excessive use of these technologies. And isn't the stark binary logic of either or, zero, one, this, that, black, white, on, off, yes, no, for, against, these polarizing, polar opposites, isn't an obsession with such binaries responsible for much of the discord that unsettles our contemporary societies? I think it is. Sorry to answer my own question. But no, I think this really has something to do with it, that this on-off, this binary, is getting into our thinking, and I think it's polarizing, certainly polarizing people in the United States, that's for sure, and probably here too. So here's my question. Why should these people determine how we want to live? I mean, who do they think they are? The rich libertarians initially planned to escape taxation and regulation by going offshore into seasteading communities. But now that their war of ideas is causing the whole planet to burn, they're aiming higher to get the hell out and colonize the moon. There we go. I mean, the sooner the better, as far as I'm concerned. Be my guest. Please, you go first. And then if not the moon, Mars. And since the human body sustains irreparable damage from spending too much time off planet, you see the studies of the people who spend a year in the space station, it fried their genes, their DNA, and so on. I mean, the human body is not evolved to whirl around the Earth for a year up there. We can reliably infer that these adventurers are post-Cartesians who regard themselves primarily as minds and only contingently as bodies. Now, I think this is not just my speculation. Well, it is, but it's confirmed by their plan B. In case they're unable to liberate themselves from the Earth, they're going to have the contents of their formidable brains uploaded to somewhere in the cloud, some cloud, while their bodies are cryonically deep frozen in anticipation of resurrection once techniques of reversing aging have been perfected. I mean, the egomania is, you have to say, it's impressive. I mean, these people are determined to hang around for as many eons as they possibly can. I just read an excellent book on this topic, something that brings all this together, Survival of the Richest, by catchy title, by Douglas Rushkoff, and I heartily recommend it. I mean, if you know what's been going on, you know a lot of it, but he pulls it all together in a very convincing story, and it's pretty depressing. I mean, these people know perfectly well what they're doing, destroying the planet, and they're going to make sure that they're okay and they don't really care about the rest of us. So yes, just because that's how they think they are, there's no need for us to buy into this kind of self-understanding. To lessen the risk of mental contagion from this nonsense, we could simply tune out a bit, disconnect from much of what the internet offers. Just unplug and turn off what we don't need. But won't we get bored? I mean, who are we if we're not good consumers? So in this last section of my presentation, I'm going to suggest an alternative. And it's called Who Else We Might Be. So I keep getting too worked up. Let's try thinking of ourselves, instead of as individuals, as relatives. And so, to whom or what are we usually relating in our lives? Well, we're related to family and friends and other members of the society we live in. We're related to all the natural beings that surround and sustain us, and we're also related to the things we live with, the so-called inanimate things. So to understand ourselves as relatives in this sense, it would mean going beyond the human in our self-understanding to include all the other beings in the world as part of who we are. Now, this might come as a surprise. Well, it didn't, because I missed the slide. But in turning toward understandings of ourselves more appropriate to these unusual times, I'm going to invoke the early speeches of Xi Jinping. Now, the reason for this is that more helpful ways of thinking about who we are in our present climatic predicament are to be found in the texts of Chinese philosophy that he was fond of quoting. When he first came into office, he quoted time and again. Books were published with these quotations in them. I'm going to begin with a speech that he gave at Peking University on the 95th anniversary of the May 4th movement in 2014. This was a huge celebration, and he went to the top university in China to give this speech. And his topic was the core socialist values. But he spent much of the speech praising the core values of the ancestors in ancient China and the glories of traditional Chinese culture. He wasn't talking so much about socialism. After weaving several quotations from classical Confucian texts into his speech, he then says, "Here are some quotations from ancient classics that I'd like to share with you today." And he goes on to hit his audience with no fewer of 20 of them in a row. Bang, 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 bang. Poor audience. But I'm going to quote some of them and start with two of them from the Analects of Confucius. First one, be trustworthy in word and resolute in deed. And secondly, if a man is untrustworthy in word, what is he good for? So this points to a central virtue for the Confucians, which is standing by one's word, always following up on what you say you'll do, because saying is a doing, and you've got to do more than just say it. And this once gave me reason to think that even though Xi Jinping is a politician, he was being sincere, since to profess Confucian ideas and then fail to carry through would entail an extreme loss of face. That expectation was, of course, disappointed fairly quickly. Xi launched his list of quotes with an idea that dates from the beginning of the Chinese tradition and refers to an original harmony between the human and the powers of heaven and earth. Harmony between heaven, or meaning in that sense, nature and humanity. And the Chinese realized it was, they were referring there to an original harmony that had to some extent got lost and was worth regaining. The practical implication of this is that human activities tend to fail when they conflict with the powers of heaven and earth, and they're more likely to succeed when integrated with them. Our insistence on burning fossil fuels, pursuing massive deforestation, and raising cattle on an industrial scale generates a volume of greenhouse gases that's actually throwing off the Earth's energy balance, disrupting the dynamic harmony that prevailed during the Holocene era. And I don't think these Chinese thinkers could have imagined that such a thing could happen, because they always see humans between the powers of heaven and earth and much smaller, much impotent in relation to those powers. But no, we're not, unfortunately. So it wouldn't be a bad idea to try to restore, it seems to me, that harmony and not throw the energy balance of the earth off even further. She returned to the topic of the harmonious coexistence of humanity and nature a couple of years later, invoking the ideas of Friedrich Engels. And this is Xi paraphrasing. According to materialistic dialectics, the world is an interrelated whole and an interactive system. This is a good paraphrase of Engels, a remarkable thinker in his in a couple of his texts. Xi then emphasized that human development activities must respect, accommodate, and protect nature. Otherwise, nature will retaliate against us. And to illustrate the point, he paraphrased a wonderful passage in the Dialectics of Nature, where Engels gives an account of civilizations that ignored the principle of protecting nature. And Engels goes through Mesopotamia, Greece, ancient Greece, Asia Minor, and Europe, and each of these civilizations suffered dire consequences as a result. So Xi then went on to list some major 20th century environmental disasters in the West, followed by a series of environmental abuses in history of China up to the Qing Dynasty in the 19th century. He didn't go any further, because if he'd gone further, he'd end up with Mao Zedong's war against nature. And he says, at the end of all that, he says, we must take warning from these cases. And he drove the point home by quoting, this is a disaster. Excuse me, we have a disaster here. We went through this before I started. Sorry about that. I'm not going to risk trying to go back to that slide, but Engels wrote, let us not flatter ourselves overmuch on account of our human victories over nature. For each such victory, nature takes its revenge on us. Something worth thinking about. Xi then showed how these ideas of Engels are anticipated in the ancient Chinese classics, citing numerous relevant passages from the Analects of Confucius, the masterpiece by the third great Confucian thinker, Xunzi, and the Spring and Autumn Annals of Liu Bei. These are the Confucian classics. The gist of all these texts is that human activities, such as fishing, hunting, and tree cutting, are especially mentioned, needs to be practiced sustainably, to use a modern term, so as not to deplete the natural sources on which our existence depends. And I think these are wonderful and timely ideas. She is quoting from the Chinese tradition, and they're all the more pertinent in the light of Xi's emphasis on their perfect compatibility with Marxist socialism on these same topics. Now, Xi's ambition for China used to be to make it into a modestly prosperous society rather than an opulent paradise of consumerism. And his often stated opposition to hedonism and extravagance and waste is correspondingly absent from political rhetoric in most Western countries. Now, Xi's attitude is perfectly in line with the Confucian encouragement of modesty and restraint, as well as the Taoist promotion of sufficiency and their warnings against excess. Again, neither the Confucius or the Taoists are saying we need to become ascetics. They're just saying just moderation is the thing. This emphasis on moderation also comes from the Chinese Buddhist tradition, and it's something that's perfectly apposite for our present era, now that we've brought the age of planetary abundance to an end. It's a pity that the Chinese middle classes have fallen for consumerism in such a big way, and we should hope that the party can persuade them that the pursuit of greater wealth and ever more pleasure is in some sense self-defeating, and that natural limits will in any case put an end to excessive levels of consumption. Now, in a speech to the third plenary session, you know what, I'm going to skip this because we did start a little late, but all these technical things. Excuse me. Excuse me, I'm going to just run through this quickly. There's more evidence of how appropriate these Chinese philosophical ideas are. Okay, we have that. I did want to mention this, that a number of studies have shown, China is being battered by climate change. So something that gives me hope is that it's in the self-interest of the Chinese, and especially in the self-interest of the Chinese Communist Party, to do something about global warming. These floods last in 2022 in China were devastating. There were devastating droughts. Sea level rise all along the east coast in China is going to, basically most of the population of Shanghai, which has 27 million people, have to move inland. Now, they can't move to the North China Plain, which is right next to Shanghai, because it's going to be too hot there, because they've been irrigating for thousands of years there, and so the wet bulb temperatures are getting higher and higher, and the combination of humidity and heat is going to mean they're going to have to move somewhere else. Probably this part of England might be a good place for them. But anyway, my point is this, that she says things like, China's low carbon emissions must not interfere with normal life. Come on, it's interfering with normal life of millions of Chinese right now. I don't get it. But there are some reasons for, people are based in the state. The Chinese Communist Party has to ensure, in order for them to survive, the long-term well-being of the Chinese people. And they say over and over again, that's what comes from Marxist socialism and from classical Chinese political philosophy. China has also been, after Joseph Nye published this book, got really keen on soft power and said, how do we get more soft power? Remember, they had the Olympics and Expo, the Shanghai Expo and so on. They spent millions, the Confucius Institutes, all to try to up their level of soft power. And it's actually a Confucian notion. It's already there. I'm sorry I'm not able to show that to you. But their soft power right now is lower than it's been in decades because they haven't been behaving themselves, because Xi Jinping has not been following what he said over those years, quoting all this wonderful philosophy. This was in, when did he say this? 2017. He gave a speech to the CCP National Congress where he said that the country was taking the driving seat in international cooperation to respond to climate change. The world is still waiting for the sound of the engine starting. If he were to follow ancient Chinese wisdom in taking the lead on slowing global warming, which is the long-term interest of the Chinese people, he would in one stroke legitimize the Communist Party's rule and gain the gratitude of the whole world and gain the greatest soft power triumph in human history. Because I don't think America's going to do it. But if China were to take the lead, I think the rest of us would have a very different view of the place. So in any case, we do well to encourage this course of action, and would, in any case, whether they go for it or not, those ideas that you only heard the first part of, about who we are, very different ideas that are in opposition to libertarian individualism, if we were to encourage thinking of ourselves as relatives rather than individuals, this would go a long way to getting us out of the predicament we're in. I think it would help us deal with the climate crisis and make it more likely that humanity can indeed survive the era that now bears our name. But one last point I need to make. While we do our best, I think it's important to try. Without cooperation of China, we fry the planet. I mean, people say, well, are you going to talk to a dictator and authoritarian? Either that or fry the planet. We still need to get to, we can work on a parallel path, getting used to getting rid of the more insidious obstructions that are preventing progress on this. We need to diminish the power of the political power of the fossil fuel concerns, get all those billions out of the political process. We need to name and shame those banks, as I said, and we need to refuse to let these people distract us and dictate to us who we are and how we are as human beings. Now, I think a very effective strategy would be to look at the gross injustice of the climate crisis. I mean, the injustice is of course, within societies, rich and poor, and between societies, the rich global north and the global south. I couldn't get more more recent figures than this, but you can see the gap is the carbon footprint gap between rich and poor is expanding. Because in 2010 it looked like that, and in 2015, now in 2022, it's going to be even more extreme than that. And that's something that should concern us. And so I want to take the last 60 seconds, more of your time, to express what we need to do above all. And we had trouble with the sound here, but I think John has seen my wave. I hope he has. Because if there's no sound, then this isn't... We'll be right back. I was getting worked up earlier. Well, I'm normally a fairly laid-back kind of a guy, but this topic gets me going. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks ever so much, Greg. Yeah.